So, React 19 was released. And by the way, I also already added some content to my React course to cover the new features added by React 19, which I'll explain in this video here as well, and to also update some of the existing lectures to be in line with React 19. Because, of course, React 19 introduced some interesting new features and changed some interesting parts of React, you could say. And of course, there already has been lots of information on React 19, but in this video here, I'll simply summarize the changes and show them in action and also explain how you can update to React 19. And I want to start with one feature that actually didn't make it into React 19, but that you can still use in your projects and that requires React 19. And that would be the React compiler, which is a new tool, you could say, that was created by the React team. And the goal of this compiler is to simplify the React code you write. Because without that compiler, you have to do quite a lot of optimizations manually in your code to produce performant React applications. At least you have to consider making these optimizations. And I'm talking about things like using the memo function or the use memo hook or the use callback hook, which you have to use to avoid unnecessary component re-evaluations and potential render cycles. With the React compiler added to your React project, the idea is that you don't have to use memo, use memo, or use callback, and that instead the compiler will kind of add those features behind the scenes to your code, though you'll never see them. Instead, that will all happen during the build process. So it will be part of the final code, but not of the code you write. That's the idea behind this compiler, but it's not stable and production ready yet. Instead, it's in experimental status, and therefore you can add it, and it does require React 19, but it's not part of React 19. Adding it is simple though. There is a page in the official documentation, and in the end, it's just a Babel plugin which you install as a package into your project, and then you update your project configuration such that this Babel plugin is being used. And that's then all. That should make sure that your code is getting optimized when you build it, for example. Now, one brand new feature that is part of React 19 would, for example, be form actions. And I mean form actions, not server actions. That's also part, but I'll get back to that later. Instead, form actions are a new feature where you can handle form submissions without listening to the submit event. So instead of adding the onSubmit prop and adding a function and preventing the browser default manually, as you had to do it before with React, you can now use the action prop on a form element and bind that to a function. Now, that's something which normally wouldn't work. It's not something the browser supports out of the box, but React supports it. And React will then invoke this function, prevent the browser default so that no request is being sent. And in that function, you'll automatically get a form data object as a parameter so that you can easily extract and use the submitted value. It's also worth mentioning that this form action function can be either synchronous or asynchronous. Both works. And it does not require any framework or server setup. Instead, this is a client-side feature. Now, React 19 also adds some new hooks that work together with that feature in the end. For example, the use form status hook, which you can use in some nested component. That must be used in a nested component, actually. So a component that's used inside of that form that is using that form action. And that use form status hook then gives you information about the current form status. And you can, for example, use it to disable the button and change some other text whilst the form is being submitted. So whilst the form action is doing some work. There also is a use action state hook, which can be used in the same component as the form action. And you can use this hook to manage some state based on that form. For example, you could use this hook to show an error message if some invalid data is submitted. Last but not least, there is the use optimistic hook, which you can use for optimistic updating in conjunction with form actions, so that you can update the UI instantly once a form was submitted, before the submitted data was processed, and then this hook will make sure that any UI changes are rolled back if the update fails, and otherwise everything will stay the way it is, but it therefore simplifies the process of optimistic updating in your UI. So these are form actions, a pretty useful, interesting new feature, which I cover in depth in my complete guide course because I added a brand new section on that. Now, another new feature, or change of an existing feature, you could say, is that with React 19, if you want to pass a ref to one of your own components, you no longer have to use forward ref. You can still use it, it won't break. React 19 is backwards compatible, but you don't have to. You can simplify your code and directly accept and extract a ref prop. It's as easy as that. So passing refs to custom components now gets a lot easier when using React 19. And of course, I also updated my course to reflect that. If you're using an older version, this of course won't work. You still have to use forward ref there. In addition, using context now became a bit easier because instead of providing context with help of a dot provider component on your context object, you can now use the context object itself as a provider component and wrap that around the JSX markup that should have access to the context. In addition, you can consume the context and get access to it with the use context hook, as you did before, but instead you could also use the new use hook, which is just called use. And that's a brand new hook, which is kind of special because, for one, it has a strange name, it's just use, but second, the rules of hooks don't apply to it, at least not all of those rules. Because whilst you still have to use it in another hook or in a React component, you can use it in an if statement, for example, something that wouldn't work with other hooks. And you can use this hook with context to get hold of a context, instead of using use context, which also still can be used, though it wasn't removed. But this new use hook is an alternative, it's a more flexible alternative, and it cannot just be used to get hold of some context value. But that leads me to a new set of features or changes to React that are part of React 19, but that you can't just use in your React 19 project. Instead, there are quite a few features which are technically part of React 19, but which in the end require a special React project setup or the use of some special libraries in order to work correctly. For example, this use hook can also be used on a promise, the idea being that you use a promise that will resolve to some value, instead of using then or async await. So you use a promise, and if you then wrap that component that uses use inside of it with suspense, React will show the fallback content until that promise resolved. And the idea here is that you have an easier time showing loading states and so on. Now, that's the idea, but use at this point of time does not work with normal promises created by you in your component. Instead, you can only use this use hook on promises that are created by libraries that integrate with the suspense feature, and you can use it on promises that are created on the server side and that are then passed to the client side, like you, for example, get it in Next.js projects. There, you can create a promise in one component and then pass that promise as a prop to another client-side component, decorated with this use client directive, and there you can then use this use hook to consume that promise. And then wrapping that component with suspense will work in the intended way. But here, of course, we now have a non-standard React project. At least we don't have one created with Vite or Create React App. Instead, we have a Next.js project because React 19 now stabilizes some features that do need such a server-side setup. Most importantly, React 19 now in the end marks React server components and therefore also client components and server actions as stable. Kind of, at least. But these are features that require a special project setup because they require a bundler that in the end treats them in a special way, you could say, and therefore they're not really usable in your regular Vite-based React projects. They require a non-trivial setup. Now, when working in a project that does support these features, like a Next.js project, you can indeed write server-side code with React now. And you actually already could do that before, because Next.js used a canary version of React in the past. So not too much changes there in the end. And the idea is that with those server-side components, you have components that are only rendered on the server, never on the client, and therefore you can, for example, use async await there to fetch data and render the UI with the fetched data so that the finished page is sent back to the client, so that the data doesn't have to be loaded there. Or alternatively, you could send that promise to the client and use the use hook to fetch it there, if you prefer to do that. If you have components, though, that need to use client-side features, for example, if you have a component that uses state, which is a client-side feature, you must mark that component as a client component by putting the use client directive at the top of the file where this component is defined. Then this component may still be rendered on the server, but also on the client. That's the difference. So that is one feature that's now marked as stable. Another feature that builds up on form actions in the end is the server actions feature. Because besides these client-side form actions, which you can use in any React project, you can also add the use server directive into your form action functions, or at the top of a file that only contains server action functions. And you can then still pass this function as a value to the action prop on a form. The difference compared to the client-side form actions will be that the server action is then executed on the server, though. So technically, behind the scenes, a HTTP request with the submitted data will be sent to the server. And therefore, in such a server action, you can safely reach out to a database and store that data, for example. In a client-side form action, you would have to send a request to some backend of your choice manually instead, and you shouldn't reach out to a database there because it's all client-side code. So the code can be accessed in the browser in the end. And then there are some other features added by React 19. For example, setting a page title and metadata now is easier because you can put title and meta tags into any of your components, and React will make sure that they end up in the head of your document. So that's another quality of life enhancement, I guess. And therefore, overall, you can easily update to React 19 because your existing code should still work. You can take a look at the official upgrade guide to learn about some cases where things might not work when using TypeScript in certain situations, for example. But overall, updating should be easy, and you can use these new features, though some of these new features, all these server-related features, might not be available to you because your project setup might not support them. But with Next.js, you can, for example, use them. And that is therefore React 19.